All right, you guys, settle down.
Okay.
All right.
Ham Radio Now, episode whatever it says down here. I don't think we're quite up to 200 yet, because, boy, wouldn't it be a celebration to be on episode
it would
number
be.
200.
I thought you would have held us out for number 200. We're relegated to number 199, Karl.
We're getting close. So I have two ARRL luminaries here, luminaries within the southeastern area. Karl Bowman, W4CHX, has been a good friend of mine for a long time, and is the new section manager for the state of North Carolina. And Bill, I'm going to make you swap. You be the microphone swapper.
All right.
When you want Karl to talk, you push the microphone in front of him. And when you don't want him to talk, you pull it away.
Okay.
Bill Morine.
Serious decorum.
Bill Morine, N2COP, has also been a friend of mine for a long, long time. Followed in my heels as public information coordinator for North Carolina. And then became section manager, something I've never had the courage to do. And now you're the assistant division director. Is that the right?
Vice director of the Roanoke division.
Vice director of the Roanoke division. Roanoke division sounds very stately.
It does.
I feel like an old oak tree when I say that. And what we're here to talk about is House Bill 1301.
1301.
Okay. And that's that thing that is going to let every ham put up all the antennas they want, at any time they want, anywhere they want. Have I got that pretty much correct?
No, Gary, I don't think we would go quite that far. Remember, hams want to be good neighbors, but we also want to be responsive to our communities around us.
And eat our broccoli and...
We all know from unfortunate incidents like 911 and Hurricane Katrina is the two poster events of the early 2000s that amateur radio continues to serve a vital role in providing largely tertiary, but when necessary, emergency communications.
Yep. Now, of course, our audience is hams primarily.
Right.
Although I suspect on a program like this, we will get some people watching who are not hams who have perhaps a contrary view of what we're trying to do here. But do we have to explain to the ham audience still the difference between municipal regulations and homeowners associations, codes and covenants? Is that, do all hams understand that now, or is that something we still, do you guys, as you're sitting here at an ARRL booth at a ham fest, are you still explaining it to people?
I am. How about
you,
Karl?
Yeah, I would agree. Municipal, the way I explain it is that municipal land use regulations encompass ordinances and use of property that would be controlled by, say, county or municipal...
state and local
rent.
Government.
Yeah, right, exactly. Private land use regulations would be those agreements, those covenants, conditions, or restrictions that would have been put in place based on a private owner going selling that property to a second owner.
Well, I concur with that, and I'll amplify on it a little, and that is that I'm astounded by the number of hams who have gone into gated communities or communities that have CCNRs, covenants, codes, and restrictions, and aren't aware that they have existed. And then when they want to put up an antenna, unfortunately, those restrictions do apply because it's a signed contract that they've entered into.
Yeah.
And that contract, the lawyers keep telling us over and over, supersedes any kind of municipal ordinance. So yes, Karl and I and other ARRL officials are still on a training mission to educate hams about the difference and to really watch out for their rights in that regard.
Okay. So since the mid-80s, we've had this thing called PRB1. Which is a federal rule, an FCC rule, with the force of law that requires states and municipalities to provide reasonable accommodation to ham radio antennas. That states and municipalities does not affect your homeowners association. Does
Correct.
Not cover them. So if you live in an area that does not have a homeowners association, then it's just the state and local government that you have to worry about.
Right, but here's the key difference. And I had a reference librarian for the state of North Carolina check this for me. So she is my source. So I want to be careful about how I do this in case somebody says to me, where'd you get that number? the trade association in North Carolina, because for your constituents, since Karl is the North Carolina section manager and I represent North Carolina as one of the four states in the Roanoke division, and I'm a former North Carolina section manager myself, this is the beta test site, if you will, for the context of which we're discussing HR 1301. In that regard, I had looked up in North Carolina, 38% of North Carolina residents live in housing that is regulated solely by municipal ordinances. And we'll define municipal in this case as either county or city, town, village. But conversely, 62% of those who live in North Carolina live in housing units that have some kind of homeowner association contract or restriction. Now, not all of that 62% are going to have antenna restrictions built in. We suspect the majority probably do. And what 1301 is going to address is those 62% of hams who live in that type of context. Now, we don't have, I don't have, nationwide numbers that tell what percentage of people live in HOA housing and what percentage of people live in housing that is regulated solely by their municipal or planning or zoning ordinances. But we suspect that probably North Carolina mirrors most other states, maybe not the western states, but perhaps east of the Mississippi. So that would, using that logic, we think that possibly the majority of hams now in the United States live in places where there's an added layer of restrictions beyond just municipal ordinances. And so that's why we're looking, that's why it's called the Amateur Radio Parity Act, to bring parity.
Parity with a T, not a D.
You're right, P-A-R-I-T-Y. But I'm babbling on here. Karl, anything you want to add?
Not right.
Give him the mic. Well, okay.
All right.
So that's a significant number, whatever number it is. There's a lot of
hams. It is significant. Even if we're off by a factor of 10% either direction, it is still an extremely significant number.
A couple years ago, ARRL's been almost consistently lobbying the FCC to include ham radio in the override of homeowners associations' rules and regulations. And sometime back in the 80s or early 90s, the FCC did an override for broadcast antennas. They call it, and something that sounds incredibly politically incorrect to me, for some reason, OTARD. The over-the-air receiving device.
Right.
There's so many different directions that those words just sound bad.
There's
when you
an
say
acronym
them.
We could have fun with for a while.
but that's it. Over-the-air receiving device. If you live in an apartment building, in a house that is covered by one of these, you can put up, no matter what my homeowners association's rules, in a fairly new development, still say no TV antennas. I can put up a TV antenna, but I can't put up a ham antenna, except when I moved in, I got a deal. Do you live in a restricted neighborhood?
Interestingly, the answer is, it's a hybrid answer. I do live in a neighborhood with restrictions, but I don't have antenna restrictions in my covenants.
Okay.
So I haven't had the problem.
You can't
so in that
keep
case,
chickens or paint your house green, but you can.
I have other covenants, but I don't have that. So interestingly, in my situation, I am governed by solely municipal ordinances.
Okay. And Karl, you're out in the woods someplace.
Well, we're in Wake County. We don't have direct, covenants, conditions, or restrictions based on where we live, even though I have three or four close neighbors, but. Like Bill, I'm governed by probably county and potentially extended jurisdiction from the city of Raleigh regulations on some things.
Yeah, the cities here have been gobbling up territory
right.
Like it's going crazy.
Right.
All right, so I'm the only one in a restricted neighborhood, but I was a ham when we moved in. It was a new neighborhood. I made the deal. With lots of reasons why hams didn't make a deal. First of all, the number one reason, I think, is the wife liked the house, so they bought that house.
Hard one to overcome.
Yes, very difficult. Or you got your ham license after you were in the house. So the hams love to wag their fingers, and I'm a good finger wagger myself.
you made the deal, you've got to live with it.
Well, you might have not known what the deal was when you bought the house.
Well, there may have been other considerations that actually trumped any potential amateur radio antenna use. I mean, an individual may have needed to move to a community quickly. There may have been safety issues. There may have been proximity to school, proximity to work.
Ham radio is not the most important. I know this is heresy to say.
Yeah.
Ham radio is not the most important decision on where you live.
So people make decisions based on what's the best situation or the best options relative to the house purchase. And they move into the house, and as you point out, they may be unaware of the restrictions associated with putting up an antenna or other things until they're actually presented with the HOA contract at the time of the signing. Or they may have been aware of them, not really thought about the implications of them from the standpoint of trying to go in front of an HOA and you know, getting some negotiating some sort of an opportunity to put an amateur radio antenna. I'm aware of, or hear about anyway, of individuals that may have lived in homes that had restrictions that were able to successfully meet with the HOA of their area, explain what they wanted to do, and everybody kind of went, okay, that's fine. So they were able to get a, quote, local variance on that or a homeowners association variance.
Good approval.
But it's not like they have a, I don't know what the right word is, legal right or a protected right to actually negotiate a reasonable accommodation. And I think that's where HR 1301 is going, because as I understand it, if 1301 is passed, it would then give Congress the authority to direct FCC to extend the PRB1 reasonable accommodation rule to private land use regulations, much the same as they did a number of years ago with regard to the over-the-air reception devices that you alluded to earlier.
Yep. So I want to take one step back.
Go ahead.
And go through just the very brief, a bit of the history. And if you guys catch anything I'm getting wrong, let me know. That was a few years ago. The ARRL has been lobbying the FCC to include ham radio in this. And the FCC finally said, we are not going to do it. We are not going to include ham radio in an override of private contracts. If you want that, go to Congress. And the Hamfest is coming down behind us. To my somewhat great surprise, ARRL successfully went to Congress and got Congress to go back to the FCC and say, not put in the override, they weren't ready to do that, but they said, do a study. We direct you to do a study and come back to us and tell us what you found. And the FCC did a study, and surprise, 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 I can say that because I'm in North Carolina, surprise, we don't need antenna relief, according to the FCC. That landed like a lead balloon on the ham radio community, and I don't think you knew it. Unless you were watching Ham Radio Now, you didn't know it. Nobody talked about this. The ARRL made a little mention on the website, we lost this round, we're going to keep fighting. They did keep fighting. And so now, this thing that we're talking about, we're kind of up to speed on, House Bill 1301, is the fight. It started last year. And what was the bill last year? Remember the number?
Yeah, it was House of Representatives Bill 4969.
Okay, does this one say exactly the same thing?
I haven't compared it word for word. My understanding is it's effectively the same bill.
Okay, and what would it do?
If the bill is passed, Congress would direct FCC to extend the PRB reasonable accommodation rule to private land use regulations. That's my understanding of the of what it is.
And for the record, neither Karl nor I are lawyers, and we're not practicing law.
And no lawyers were harmed in the making of this program. Although some may be getting their undies in a bunch at this point.
Right.
So it's pretty simple. What has to happen for this to go beyond a House bill?
Well, I can answer that to a certain extent. U.S. lawmaking requires that there, for a law to be successful, that there be a bill introduced both in the United States House of Representatives and in the U.S. Senate. Right now, H.R. 1301 is the House version. There is no Senate version at this time. At the time that we're taping this program, April 4th of 2015. So I know
not April
ARRL,
1st.
April, yes. So we know that ARRL is seeking to see if they can get a Senate member to be a sponsor of a Senate version of H.R. 1301 so that the bills can be heard in both chambers and then possibly go for, if passed, go to conference and then go to the president for signature.
Okay, so that's, you know, that's our standard legislative procedure.
That's right.
You know, I'm Mr. Bill up on Capitol Hill.
That's right.
We all learned that in the cartoon.
I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill, and I'm sitting here on Capitol Hill.
So we need a Senate bill.
Right.
We need the House to pass it. It didn't pass last year.
Right.
It wasn't voted on. It just, like many, probably like most bills, it just, what do they say, died in committee?
Listen to those congressmen arguing. Is all that discussion and debate about you?
Yeah, I'm one of the lucky ones. Most bills never even get this far. I hope they decide to report on me favorably. Otherwise, I may die.
Die?
Yeah, die in committee.
I think there's a friendly environment this year. I think one of the overarching questions perhaps viewers and the ham community as a whole should be asking is, why is ARRL, and not because it's ARRL, but because it is the chief advocacy entity for amateur radio, moving in this direction now? And I think that may be more telling than anything else as to why this avenue of pursuit is being pursued at this time. The world, as we all know, MCOM-wise, changed dramatically with 911 and with Hurricane Katrina. And that even in this age, there's still a need for secondary and even tertiary emergency communications. And there's no question that interoperability hasn't yet been achieved, some now going on almost 15 years after 911. And ham radio is as close as you get to almost perfect interoperability. And with that in base there, it's a wonderful winning combination for politicians in the sense of the appeal. We're unpaid volunteers. Part 97 says we cannot be compensated for services. We buy our own equipment. We maintain our own equipment. We volunteer to the community at no charge to taxpayers. One of the things that our hobby has not done well, either through ARRL or outside ARRL, is that we don't have a good handle monetarily of what the equivalent value is of the services that we provide or that the equipment that we offer for use, which the taxpayer doesn't have to pay for. In 2007, when North Carolina passed its equivalent state PRB1 law, at that time, we took what information that we had in North Carolina, we made some assumptions, and these are assumptions. I want to be very careful. This is not empirical data. These are assumptions that we put together of the number of active hams, the number of hours donated, the value of their stations, and the value of repeaters installed base in North Carolina. When we add that together, along with the volunteer time, we came up with a number that we felt very comfortable with as being a round and somewhat conservative number. We felt in the neighborhood of $20 to $25 million per year being given in equipment and services to the taxpayers of North Carolina at no charge to them. Now, we know that in North Carolina, the state antenna law applies roughly to about 38% of constituents. There's 62% that would be represented if passage is successful of H.R. 1301. So extracting that algorithm, if 38% represent, excuse me, if the $20 or $25 million of in-kind donation represents the majority of the 38% who can operate more unfettered.
Is there going to be a quiz?
No. Then the question is, what would happen both in the state of North Carolina and nationwide if suddenly hams who have been impinged upon their ability to put up antennas in HOA-restricted neighborhoods and now have that cap taken off. Let's use North Carolina's example. Does that mean that our equivalent base now of 20 to 25 million of donated equipment and services would rise to $30, $35 million? We don't know.
And but it again, would get bigger.
Okay, so but the point is that we know that there'd be somewhere between maybe a one-third to 100% increase possibly in the nationwide ability for hams to participate in MCOM and donate time and services that both the state and federal taxpayers would not have to do. I think one of the things we have not done well as an amateur radio community is been able to tell elected officials, tell appointed officials, tell the community at large what a resource we are, not only in what it is we do, but also from a monetary viewpoint. This is free money to taxpayers, or the equivalent of free money. And I think we need to tell that story and tell it effectively.
It's not just emergency communications. There's all kinds of public service stuff that goes on.
Right, right.
Outside emergencies.
Right. You know that where I live in Wilmington, North Carolina, we have one of the 140.6-mile iron distance triathlons. That is a 17-hour event. The athletes are given 17 hours from start to finish to complete that event.
I won that last year. This isn't April 1st. This is April 4th.
Yeah. And there's a case where we take the standard ARRL formula that's used in the public service form that's available on ARR's website. It's form FSD 157. And using that formula, we have come up with around $30,000 to $35,000 of equipment and services donated at no charge to that race. And the beneficiary of that race is a nonprofit organization, the local YMCA for urban scholarships. Yeah. So our point is there's another example. That's not MCOM, but that's public service. And that's
so those are the things we can point to that that make us the good guys.
Right.
Antennas make us the bad guys.
Antennas make us the bad guys, but there's one more thing.
At least in some people's
view. Poor Karl here. He hasn't had a chance to say anything in so long.
I've got a plan for Karl here, because I'm going to let you go, because you have to get going.
I want to make one more point, if I can. One of the common arguments I hear from community associations in the fact they don't want a hand swap antennas is, if we have an emergency, you can put up an antenna then. One of the things that makes ham radio interoperability a success is the ability to change frequencies, change procedures, change check-in times, and unless you practice that, you will not be proficient at it. So putting an antenna up immediately after an emergency is not the time to do it. It is ongoing practice, and therefore those antennas need to be up full time.
There's a handful of hams whose primary interest is in emergency communications, but an even smaller handful that would have the dedication to have equipment they couldn't use until the hurricane was on the way. Almost nobody would do anything like that. So that's the point. And if you out there in the audience need to refine that argument, to understand that we wouldn't be hams if we couldn't play with the radios except during the emergency. We wouldn't have it, and we wouldn't know how to use it even if we had it. I think Karl wants to grab the mic.
I think a related component to the idea of practicing in preparation for the emergency service or emergency communications that Bill's mentioned is the fact that in the process of working with your amateur radio station, hams are focused on optimizing the station. The antennas, and the protocols and the ways in which it's used. And you learn over time as you adjust an antenna or as you gain experience with the operating conditions that are available to you, which are affected by time of year and atmosphere and time of day, that you're optimizing the radio so that when, you know, emergencies don't pick the time when they occur. And the idea of putting an antenna up, you know, may be fine in daylight with low wind, but it may not be so doable with slightly higher wind and at dark. But yet, and also, you know, you would have had experience prior to that time of operating your radio in those conditions.
And only the simplest antennas can be put up,
of course,
in a day or less. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. And many antennas are very complex.
Yeah. I'm going to let you go in a minute. I'm going to ask Karl about some of his experience in making contact with government officials, because he's had some experience doing that. But you guys here at the ARRL booth at the HamFest have been signing up hams or getting hams to sign letters. So before I let you go, I want you to put in your two cents on what individual hams can do, need to do now, right now, while you're thinking about it, to push this effort forward this year. What should hams do? Grab that mic.
Actually, I'm going to turn it back to Karl, because I actually think in the last 30 days or so, you've been more active in this regard than I have, and that is hams out there. If you're going to a ARRL HamFest in the next few weeks, many of those HamFests will have at the ARRL booth a software program that will look up your call sign, look up your address, and will automatically populate it with the correct name of the U.S. congressman or congressperson in your district that you can send a letter of support for H.R. 1301. You don't need to file it. ARRL will forward these on your behalf at no charge to you.
And
you don't have to be an ARRL member, by the way, to participate in that project.
It's better doing it that way.
Well, it's better because many people may know that after the anthrax scare years ago, that physical mail gets segregated, and it can take up to 1 month for a letter to physically be delivered by the United States Postal Service. Instead, ARRL has a service in Washington, D.C., which walks those up and delivers them by hand to the congressman's office, getting them there much more quickly. Email will do, too, even facsimile.
Do you think you could
try sending a radiogram if you want.
Do you guys have a sense of which is more powerful in terms of making an impression at your congressman? Your signature on the bottom of a form letter that hopefully they got a few dozen of, or something crafted by you personally?
I don't know how to answer that question, to be honest with you. I don't know what goes into that decision making. I think they're all important. Any effort on the part of an individual to communicate with a representative expressing a concern in an appropriate manner is going to be listened to. So that's my reply.
So if they're not at a ham fest, is there something they can do sitting at home
now? Yes, and let me just add on that. I think, unfortunately, I wish I could say content is really paramount, but I think it's a numbers game. There's a staffer sitting there saying X number of people are for H.R. 1301 in our district. So many people in our district are against 1301. And that will be a deciding factor on whether or not a U.S. representative may consider co-sponsorship of the legislation.
Right. But
yes, those who are not going to be at a ham fest can go to find out who the representative is. You can do a search engine on a computer. You can go to www.house.gov, I think it is. Or just put in the search engine, who's my congressman? And then find out who that person is, find out their email address, and just send. It can be as simple as saying, please give your consideration to become a co-sponsor for H.R. 1301, the Amateur Radio Parity Act of 2015.
So we want co-sponsors, not necessarily just support.
Right. Co-sponsorship is very, very key, because that also indirectly determines whether by sheer numbers, if a bill will be heard before a committee.
All right. So I'm going to let you go, because you got to get back down to Wilmington.
Right.
Get prepared for the next hurricane.
Not the next hurricane. At the time of this taping, we're in the NCAAs, and so I have other priorities, Gary.
All right. I understand.
I want to thank you, and I want to thank, I've been a longtime viewer, and I know many of your viewers are longtime viewers. I want to thank you, take a moment and say, for the quality in which you put into your programming of talking about different issues. One of the things I like about your format over other formats in amateur radio is that you take an issue and explore it in depth with, in most cases, subject matter experts. You somehow managed Karl and me to be here today. And I applaud you for that. I think so many people don't realize there are so many things which make our hobby great, but which, like all family discussions, and we're one big family of this universe of amateur radio, we want to discuss them. So it's kind of like a nice talk at the family table of what the issue of the day is, and thank you for providing that.
Thank you, Bill. Appreciate that. Someone has been paying attention. I'm telling you guys that all the time. All right, I'm going to let you go. I'm going to reconfigure the cameras a bit, and Karl and I will talk about experience that he has had actually talking to a congressman. So I'm going to fade to black. Don't go away. Okay.
Gary.
We got rid of Bill. He's just an anchor. Blah, 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 blah.
No, that's not true.
So, the thing that you were telling me the other day when we were down in Charlotte was that you have had experience actually going to a congressperson's office
right. And
talking to them about this. I think that is almost unique, something that most people have not even come close to having the experience of, and probably the most valuable thing we can impart to right. This audience.
Right.
So tell me about what you did.
Well, a little background, if I may.
Oh, sure.
Prior to July of last year, I would have never dreamed that I would have been involved in anything like this. I think it's important, the idea that reasonable accommodation of amateur radio antennas in city ordinances, municipal land use regulations, as well as private land use things, is allowed. And I understand the rationale behind it, and obviously support the kind of legislation that would lead to those kind of permits. So when H.R. 4969, which was the Amateur Radio Parity Act of 2014, was announced, as I recall, in late June, I began to realize that this was going to be a matter for amateur radio operators to understand. And as the section manager, I had to communicate parts of that to the hams that were in my section.
As we discussed.
Exactly.
Hams
right.
confuse
right.
what PRB1 covers, right. what this would cover.
Right. So I knew it was important for me to try to understand the issues, to convey those issues, and not make mistakes. And, you know, it's important. I don't want to make mistakes for any obvious reason, but I also don't want to create a problem for ARRL or amateur radio in general. So it's a learning process. Now, the grassroots campaign, which was established by ARRL for HR 4969, had two components to it. There was a letter writing campaign, and then there was a request for hams that could arrange to visit with their local representative in small groups to request support of the bill by becoming co-sponsors. And there was time frames, and we understood that, for instance, as this was going into play in July and August, that Congress was going to be going on summer recess, and we were trying to get co-sponsors, because that is the possibility for advancing legislation, hopefully, for passage. So we became aware of the letter writing campaign, and then subsequently small groups. Again, I never really imagined that I would be one of those individuals. Well, as it turns out, in this section of North Carolina, we have a very capable state government liaison, and another...
That's an ARRL position.
Yes,
it is. Most people
you.
Probably haven't heard of.
Right. Well, there's a number there's section managers, and then there's a number of other individuals that carry on important tasks. You can have section emergency coordinator, section traffic manager. One of them is a state government liaison, and that individual is very experienced. The other individual the three of us, there were three of us, myself and another individual from the club I'm in, we'd had experience with trying to get some amendments to the local ordinances, the new ordinances that were in Raleigh. So the three of us realized that because we worked together, understood some of the issues, that we would attempt to set up a meeting with our local representative. And our state government liaison called the representative's office, and as it turned out, we got an appointment in the office at a time when the representative was on recess and would be in Raleigh, North Carolina. So, having...
Just in case anybody's confused, this is your U.S. Congress
correct.
Representative.
Yes.
Not a, Not a state legislature, no. not US a city alderman,
right.
U.S. Congress.
Right.
We don't need to say which one,
right.
but one of the North Carolina Congress.
So as we start thinking about it, it's like, well, what do? We knew, for instance, that we were going to meet in Raleigh. We had been offered the opportunity to meet with them for 15 minutes. So we knew that we had to get the message out and that it would either be received or not received. But at the end of 15 minutes, we had to deliver the message politely, answer questions, and thank them for our time and hopefully get a positive result. So we understood the importance of preparations. So we read up on the bill as best we could. The ARRL had provided through the website talking points that had been carefully prepared by ARRL counsel that were factual and were probably not going to get us into any difficulty. I mean, you know, truthfully.
Yeah.
And so we wanted to understand those things.
Did you talk to anybody at headquarters at this preparation?
A little bit. I mean, we did. We had
a meeting with a congressman is a big deal.
Well, we thought so. And we mostly talked among ourselves. We met and talked. So, what do we need to do? We understood the talking points. We decided we would divide some of those talking points so that we, while there was three of us going, we wanted to be sure that it was all three of us talking, so that it was a conversation and that it wasn't just one person leading the other two.
Were you happy with the points the league was recommending
yes,
you talk
very
about?
Yes, very much so. Very
were
much
there
so.
Things you thought you wanted to talk about that they didn't include?
No, not at all. There was plenty
inclusive.
Of talking points, and I was comfortable knowing that those talking points were well thought out, that they were bluntly not going to get us in trouble. And I mean, really.
Are these things available for anybody to see on the league's website?
Could, You go to the ARRL website and click on, currently it would be 1301. There's a home page for that, and there's information. I haven't looked at the talking points this year yet, and there's a reason why. And that's because I'm waiting for direction, so to speak, on just the full extent of the grassroots campaign. But last year, these talking points were available. So I'm talking about last year now, not this year.
Yeah, your meeting was in last year's.
That's correct. It was end of August, early September last year. So we had the information. We got some advice on how to dress. I mean, you want to go in basically in your Sunday best.
You want this torn jeans. You want
right, exactly.
Stained T-shirt that says Hams do it with more frequency.
Right, right. No, you want to go in and you want to be professional. And you want to be conversant, and you want to be polite, and able to address the situation. So that's how we prepared. And the day of the meeting came. We went to the representative's office, and we were met by very polite, very capable individuals that checked us in, as you would expect. You show ID and sign a log.
Congressional staff.
Yeah,
we've
right.
all watched The West Wing.
Right.
We know
right.
how this works.
Well, I don't watch that show. But the point is that we met people, and then when our appointed time came, we went to a conference room where a senior staff aide was present, and the three of us, and we were soon joined by our representative. So it was five individuals, and it was remarkably easy. I mean, in the sense of it was comfortable, it was conversational, I felt at ease.
This is going to be somewhat situational,
right,
depending
exactly.
on the congressperson.
Right. But we were able to, we had adequate time to express why we were there. Obviously, we had sent information ahead of time as to what we wanted to talk about.
Did he or she seem somewhat prepared for what you were going to talk about?
Yes, I think that yes. I think
so
for the most part,
staff
yes.
gave him at least walking down the hall,
right,
the staff
right, yeah,
gave
right.
him a briefing.
And we had time to answer questions, and as questions came up, we knew among ourselves probably who the best person was to answer, so the idea of a question being asked to one individual and then deflected to the other, it didn't look like shuffling. We just kept it going. And we were surprised, or I was surprised anyway, because our 15-minute scheduled conference period time actually went longer. And I don't remember exactly what it was, but it was more in the order of at least 35, if not 40 minutes or more. And it, like I said, it was comfortable, and I felt like we had gotten our information across, been received. We felt like we'd been heard.
And was the staff person that was there, were they engaged or what, as well, or were they just wallpaper?
They were engaged, but I don't remember the degree to which they were engaged. No question they were following the conversation. I didn't feel the presence of the staff person as an impediment or a problem.
Well, I guess what I'm getting at is the staff is probably getting more helpful to you than the congressman is.
Yeah, I don't know how to answer you on that, to be honest
with you. Well, in terms of making contacts and doing things, the staff does all the legwork. The congressperson gets brought in for the big show.
Right. But the congressman,
and then shuffled
the congressman
out.
The conversation was between the three of us and our congressman.
Yeah. Now, was he engaged?
Yes.
He asked good questions?
Yes.
Did he ask any tough questions?
Not really. I think the one question was, do you know who your opposition is?
Which is something I want to talk about,
right,
too.
Right, and I'm not sure I know that completely, who it was, but my understanding is there is a nationwide organization of homeowners associations. The abbreviations of that group escapes me now. I knew it at the time. But we understood that they had a stake in this matter, so to speak, and that they would likely be opposition. And we were asked why, and I said obviously they would be probably concerned about loss of property value in the face of what might be viewed as a unaesthetic antenna or things like that. And I think we just tried the best we could to acknowledge what the concerns would be.
So you didn't try to sugarcoat it or tiptoe around what, it's not your job to make their case, but your congressman asked you what the opposition might be.
Yeah, what we thought.
It became your job to make
the
case.
Yeah, what we thought our opposition might be.
Yeah.
And that was pretty much the extent of that conversation.
I wonder if the Congress people will seek out opposing, you don't know whether they'll seek out opposing viewpoints if they want to come talk to me, I'll listen to them.
Yeah,
but I'm not going to go looking for it.
I don't know if they'll seek it, but I do know that I think the congressman was supportive of what we were trying to do. But we were also advised that he needed more information.
So you didn't get a commitment out of this?
No, we did not get on that visit. But the commitment we got was, I think that, well, clearly listened to what we had to say. And I think that they were going to investigate it further, get further information so that, a decision can be made.
Did they come back to you or
eventually,
anyone?
Yeah. I mean, we eventually did. And they, I don't remember how the communications went exactly, because during the fall there were periods when Congress was in session and not in session. So obviously, when they're in session, you obviously look for new co-sponsors coming on. And, that would be confirmation if the individual that we had spoken with had become a co-sponsor. That didn't occur. We eventually got a very nice letter. One of the operative phrases in there was, we're going to monitor the progress of this bill, and we'll, I'm informed to where I can take action later, as I recall.
So you didn't get a sense, not even just not a commitment, but they were completely noncommittal, interested, aware, but not giving you I think you got a good point.
The better way to characterize that is I walked out of that meeting encouraged. I was encouraged by the fact that the meeting went smoothly.
Yeah.
I didn't feel like we had made any overt errors.
You were heard. You were not
heard,
shot down.
Right. And I kind of walked away and I thought, this might happen.
Okay.
So that's probably the best way to describe, or give you the answer to the question you asked.
Obviously, it's going to be different in every congressional office.
Correct.
Because they are individuals with very different personalities and backgrounds and motivations.
Correct.
Did you get the sense that there was a political component? Is this a political question? It's Congress, it's Washington, everything is politics, but not every issue has a real strong black and white, left and right, red and blue component to it. Do you get the feeling anywhere that this did? We don't want it to.
I don't know how to answer you on that one, to be honest with you. I just felt it was a process. We were trying to... we were requesting support for the bill by co-sponsoring.
The co-sponsor group last year was bipartisan. I don't know what the breakdown was, but there were Democrats, there were Republicans, and we're aiming for that. we want this to be nonpartisan.
Correct.
You know, we as hams don't have any advantage in it becoming a very partisan deal.
No.
And with a Republican Congress, you know, if it were a strong Republican issue, well, that might weigh in our advantage, right. In our favor some. But even then, I don't particularly think so. This isn't something someone is going to be staking their political reputation on. This is a background issue.
Right. I don't know. I understand what you're.
I'll play pundit. You play source.
I don't know.
Yeah. All right.
Excuse me.
Well, mostly what we're looking for is the experience, and right. You've related that pretty well.
The experience was, I'm glad I did it. That's my take-home point. Yeah. It was doable, and I would do it again.
And you may need to.
Exactly.
Because this is, last year is gone.
Right.
As you're going through getting hams to sign the letters here at the Ham Fest, if you sign one last year, you need to sign another one this
correct.
Year.
That's correct.
And I guess the same thing would apply to congressional office visits. If you were to go back, his memory wouldn't be erased of what you did. You know, it might not be. He might not even get the opportunity to go back again. It might be a staff contact saying, mm-hmm. "Here's our deal. We're still doing it. Can we meet?" And they may say, "No, we know what you're all about. We'll give it the consideration again this year." Who knows how they're going to
I don't know how it's going to go. And you raise an interesting point because you've talked about this year. And with regard to this year, obviously I've had experience from last year. I've learned that that there is a grassroots campaign, that it had a letter writing component, that it had a small group visits to the representatives, that there was a process by which co-sponsors were added to the bill. And I have a sense, not a complete sense, but I have a sense of kind of what's needed. HR 1301 this year is relatively new. I mean, it's newly introduced.
And earlier than last year by a lot.
Well, correct, but I think that I don't sense that there is the. I mean, this is important, and we need to get things done quickly if we can. But I don't sense there's the urgency to try and get the co-sponsors on board as rapidly as last year, because last year was time dependent. I mean, introduced June, July, with the hope that by the end of the legislative session in December, as I recall, that it would be to the point where it was a bill that could go. And we knew that that there was a series of recesses in there, both for vacation as well as for that period just prior to elections. And so there was a push, so to speak, to try and get a fair number of things done, in other words, letter writing and the visits during this period of time. I think there is an urgency to move this one forward now. But what I'm seeing is that the letter writing campaign is happening. I'm still waiting for some direction on, for instance, all of the talking points and things like that to support the visits to a congressman. So that's what we're doing right now.
When you talk to people above your pay grade, maybe headquarters, you know, right. Jim Boner, our section manager, our
division
director,
right, yeah.
This is the. So this is one of my somewhat more jerky questions to ask. No one outside of the ARRL expected it to pass last year, and no one expects it to pass this year, but you can't say that.
Right.
If you're in the circle, you have to make the public relations pitch that it can happen this year.
Right.
I don't expect it to happen this year. I think if it ever happens, and I hope it does, it's a long road effort. And if the magic mix comes together that pushes it through this year or next year, well, wonderful.
Right.
Not going to complain about that.
Right.
But we're not expecting that. What can you say about that?
It's an interesting question.
Because if you say, well, you know, it's not going to happen this year, I'm going to slack off. You can't do that either.
No, I'm not prepared to slack off. There are things that need to be done. I'm trying to provide appropriate communications to the ARRL members about this bill. and things that they can do. I am waiting, I don't want to say waiting, it's the wrong word. I am looking for the direction that I know is going to come. And it's going to come from the ARRL staff, it's going to come from the legal counsel, it's going to come from the policymakers on the board, which is the, you know, the division directors and above. They're going to tell us how we can be effective at the section manager and at the member level. So some of that. I'm encouraged by that because I know that some of the, I don't want to say mistakes because they're not, or the problems because they're not problems, but I know that some of the glitches that we ran into last year are being resolved, have been resolved, and are going to be better. So
can you feel comfortable talking about what
talking the points as an example? You know,
what things to bring up?
Right, exactly.
What things turned out to be at least small landmines?
Exactly, right. And things like that. I know right now that I'm encouraged that the database that's needed to help ARRL members that want to generate a letter to their congressman is being made available to individuals like myself so that we can provide a letter that has the appropriate congressman's name on it with appropriate text and a signature, so that if the ham agrees with the letter, decides he wants to sign it, that we can provide that, you know, that they can do that, and then we can take that letter and get it in the most efficient manner to that representative.
Yeah.
That's great. I mean, that's good. And that's what I'm focused on right now.
The American public is, by and large, not very politically engaged.
Okay.
Don't know if the ham radio population is more engaged than the public at large or not. I suspect we're a little more engaged. You've run into a lot of people who don't know who their congressman is.
Yeah, that's true. And I, you know, there's any number of reasons why. One of the things that's interesting to me is we have an amateur radio operator's name and a zip code, and we put it into the database, and the database can't discriminate on the zip code alone who the representative is for that ham. And I think that's an effect of redistricting and or new elections, change of guard.
Yeah, that happened to me.
Exactly.
And it took me the next primary for me to say, oh, wait, I've got a new congressperson.
Right, exactly, yeah. So I think that's what we're encountering. And that's just an educational thing. I mean, you work through that.
Yeah. We could wring our hands about it, but it's just a fact of life, and it's something to deal with. It's something that you have a mechanism for dealing with.
Gary, you were asking a question to me earlier about progress. And do you stop while you're waiting and everything else? I don't remember the context of the question, but I had a thought I wanted to share with you. When this bill was reintroduced this year, 1301, it had, as I recall, the original sponsor and 12 co-sponsors, including one representative from our state, which was great. So I thought, okay, you know, I'd sort of been advised that this was going to go a little slower. It would take more time to build the momentum to get additional co-sponsors. And I was generating the North Carolina section newsletter last weekend. I think it was the 28th or Sunday or whatever day it was that I was actually looking at the database. So I went to houseofrepresentatives.gov. I used Google and searched HR 1301 and pulled up the appropriate website, and is able to look at sponsors and co-sponsors. And by the way, that's a very useful website if you're trying to track legislation or learn something about things, is to, for instance, get a search engine, enter the bill you're interested in, bring up the appropriate web page, and take a look at kind of what's going on. Anyways, the reason I bring this up is because I all of a sudden discovered that we had 31 co-sponsors now for this bill. And I kind of went, wow, that's going faster than I thought. So with any, that makes me optimistic about the idea that, well, maybe there is more support for this than we think. And maybe with a little bit more activity on the part of concerned hams, providing letters, activity on the part of ARRL members, and maybe some of our activities assisting the members, you know, in an appropriate fashion, maybe we can move this forward. I would be encouraged, for instance, if all of a sudden I found out that there was a companion Senate bill that
which
had been introduced.
Which is mandatory. We have to have one.
But I mean, when that appears, that's going to be like a, oh, gee, that's an important step.
To me, it's going to be a,
yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, I know. But I mean,
this may happen.
Right. But it's like where I was before. I walked out of that meeting with our representative, and I thought, well, this is possible. And I'm still in that mode.
All right. Trying to think of what else would be useful for people to understand.
I think there's a couple things. I think the getting educated. There's still a lot of education things on this I have to get educated on. But I would read the bill. It's not very long. I would try to understand what PRB1 is. I might go back and try to refresh my memory on what the over-the-air reception device is, what that is, and what was some of the issues that were around that. And of course, the abbreviations of that, OTARD, OTARD. Maybe read about that, learn a little bit about that, and to maybe read about some of the passages that FCC has mentioned about they're looking for Congress to give them direction on bringing PRB1 into the private land use contracts. And I think that, you know, if you begin to understand that, you begin to, I think, have an understanding of the pros and cons. Because not everybody's going to agree with this.
Not all hams are going to agree
with
that.
That's my point. I mean, not everybody's going to agree that this is the thing to do.
The one show that I've done about this, a seriously dedicated show about this whole topic, was titled No on last year's bill. And it wasn't my opinion. I want to see it pass. But I was approached by a viewer who wanted to talk about it. And I said, well, let's do a show about this. Let's bring your point of view out. Right. And it is a private contract. And somewhat libertarian view, but the idea is let's not have the government intrude. And it may be an oversimplification to say hams lean conservative, but I think it's probably true. If you hear political discussions on the air, you don't hear very many liberal ones, and you hear a fair number of conservative ones. Most of us stay away from that entirely, but the ones you hear tend to be a bit more conservative,
right.
Maybe a lot more conservative.
Right.
And as a something that the government is going to step in and say, private contract, we are overriding you. That is not a conservative argument. That's you've got to get over something to support that.
Yeah, you know,
it's your ox being gored now. It's your antenna ox.
Yeah.
But
it depends on how you view. It's a really tough one. I'm talking now more. I have to talk as an individual on this.
You're allowed to.
Yeah, right. I know. But I guess I don't. I'm not looking at it as deeply as the idea that the federal government is stepping in and wants to jump all over these regulations. I think the issue for me is that it kind of gets back to something that's a little more important to me anyway, and that is that a number of years ago, the federal government found that it was in their best interest to allow amateur radio operations for any number of reasons, including public service and emergency communications. And when you start thinking about the idea of allowing amateur radio communications, you start talking about reasonable accommodations for antennas and things like that. And so when you talk about municipal regs, you know, county, city, municipality ordinances, you would like to be able to allow a ham to operate. And hopefully they're favorable. And there's advantages, obviously, to being able to put antennas up that are taller, because that optimizes, communications, propagation. And that's regardless of whether that's UHF, VHF, or HF communications. And then when you start looking at private land use things, when you start talking about a ham that wants to operate a base station, optimize their ability to communicate in times of need or any other time where they're trying to work on their station, work on antennas, it seems like there could be a reasonable accommodation there. And as I said earlier, I think I hear about hams, I can't put a name on it, but I hear about hams that have moved into an area and have successfully petitioned an HOA and have said, this is what I'd like to do, and they reach an accommodation. And it seems to work.
Yeah, I think more often hams don't even try. It's easier to seek forgiveness than permission.
Right, and that has its own set of problems.
Well,
But the flip side is, again, when you look at this bill, if it's passed, again, to my way of thinking, it's just saying, okay, it gives the ham an opportunity to sit down with their HOA to figure out what's in a reasonable accommodation.
Yeah.
As I understand it, it's not going to completely negate HOAs and their concerns.
And that may be the most important point. It absolutely is not going to do that.
Right.
It's going to require them to talk to us.
Right.
And it doesn't even guarantee us any success.
Well, the example that I use, and I'm not sure this is the best example, it makes sense to me to use this example, but if this bill is put in play and a ham were to negotiate reasonable accommodations in a private land use situation, you know, if they lived in an apartment, it's not like all of a sudden they're going to be able to put a 60-foot tower up with a three-element Yagi. I mean, they might.
Even in a house.
Well, yeah, but in that situation, the reasonable accommodation may be something that balances a number of needs, whereas a ham that lives in a suburban area where there's land, say 3-acre lots, lots of trees, houses set back, and you may find that a reasonable accommodation there might allow a ham to put up a tower with some sort of a Yagi, and yet you would not see it from, neighbors wouldn't see it, wouldn't be seen from the street, and it might meet, that might be a reasonable accommodation meeting everybody's needs as well. So that's how I view that.
Yeah. I've seen news stories on occasion crop up where a TV station will interview, an antenna situation has occurred.
Right.
There's been some fairly recent ones. And they'll talk to the ham and they'll talk to the neighbors. And there's hard, polarized opinions.
Right.
That's what you get into when you get that far along the line and there hasn't been negotiation. So the idea of accommodation is nebulous. There was somebody in the ARRL forum earlier today, I think you were manning the booth. They were complaining that, it's just watery language. Why don't we have something more specific? We're not going to get something more specific. We're barely going to get this. We've got lots of history to look at for what the term reasonable accommodation has done for us outside the homeowner associations, but inside the realm of local and municipal and state governments, where PRB 1 had effect, and it wasn't an instantaneous grant of authority to put up an antenna. In many cases, it was a fight, and in some cases, we lost, or the ham who was making the fight lost. I think the hams who lost more often than not put up the antenna and then went to seek permission. They're pretty much the wrong way to go. But I guess what I'm trying to say is it can often be a case of tell it to the judge. Somebody is going to make the determination of what a reasonable accommodation is.
Right.
And if you and your homeowners association can't figure it out and you want to push it that hard, you go to court. And you may win and you may not. But without the ability to fight the homeowners association, without this law in place, you can't even go to court. You can't go anywhere. You're done.
Yeah, I just can't comment on that. I mean, there's so many variables in what you just described. You can't comment on it.
It's basically true.
Right.
And we did a show with Fred Hopengarten, who's one of the attorneys that has fought many of these cases, and we're still waiting for a fella in Ohio to wait for his town to exhaust its last legal remedy to prohibit him from putting up an antenna when every court along the way has said, no, go ahead, you're entitled to do this, and they're one last Supreme Court Ohio Supreme Court step away. So
that's interesting. Yeah.
Waiting for that to get resolved, and hopefully you'll be able to put up an antenna while there's still radio to be able to talk on.
Right.
All right. So we need a Senate bill. We need to get as many co-sponsors for the House bill as we can.
Right.
And we need hams to understand what we're doing.
Right. Exactly. I think that's fair. And again, it gets back to the hams learning about the issues, understanding it, making a decision. If they feel they can support it, try and do what they can do to support it. Like I said, the ARRL last year had a grassroots campaign consisting of the letter writing and the small group visits with representatives. And I think as this campaign gets better established, we're going to have better direction on what can be done. So I'm, like everybody else, I'm waiting for direction.
Good deal. You got a basketball game to go watch, or are you going to go to dinner?
I watch basketball.
We will miss you. Thank you, Karl.
You're
welcome. Appreciate
it.
Thanks to Bill. And let's look at this camera together over here.
Okay.
Turn off to
yep.
your right.
There I am.
And I will say, you've seen how these programs go. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Karl, W4CHX.
Oops, God, it's the microphone thing. Haven't you been in ham radio for a while?
No, I know.
So what are you, a CW operator? Let's try this again. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Karl Bowman, W4CHX.
Over.
Over.
No, you say and out. Haven't you ever watched Dick Tracy? All right.
You don't say over and out.
We're gonna rehearse this one. Well, you know, it's bad radio procedure.
Right.
I've been told, get that microphone up there. I've been told, I did this first on Ham Nation a long, long time ago,
right.
And I instantly got email from someone to say, it's bad radio procedure, it's Hollywood radio procedure.
Right.
If you say over, it means I'm turning it over to you.
Right.
If you say out, it means
you're leaving.
I am gone.
Right.
To me, over and out, besides being just a great sounding thing to say, is you can talk, I'm not going to be listening.
Right.
I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Karl Bowman, W4CHX.
Over.
And out.
Give me my microphones back.
And that's it. Wait a second, don't you have to go through Congress at some point?
Oh, that's adorable. You still think that's how government works.